You recognize the characters in the picture? Okay. This slide basically reiterates what I was talking about in terms of stress treatments. So on the left covers drug substance, and on the right is drug product, which I said I wouldn't cover much. And you have the different stress treatments here for solids and solutions slash suspensions. And a realistic example design of what we do, and these are taken literally from our MDS reports, are designs for solid and aqueous stress. And we cast a pretty wide net if you look at the detail. I will use my red pointer here. And say we have a control condition for solids, and then we freeze-thaw, we expose to light, we expose to heat, heat plus humidity, and we go to a fairly high temperature of 120 degrees. Once again, it's not always going to end up that way. Samples might over-degrade, and then you have to redo some degradations in order to hit your targets. For aqueous, somewhat of a similar story. And I never fail to do that when using the pointer. But acid-based, neutral, oxidative, aqueous, unbuffered, we have the typical media by which to do this, such as dilute acid, dilute base, phosphate buffer. For neutral and oxidative, dilute hydrogen peroxide, and various durations and temperatures to cover all our bases. I also like to expose samples to light in solution or suspension state, because sometimes you get an enhancement of what you might miss in the solid state. Okay, so I try to drive the point that we have a plan, but sometimes plans don't go perfectly, and you may over-degrade or under-degrade. And there is an Arrhenius model assumption that says that for every 10 degrees increase, the degradation rate is doubled. And for every decrease, conversely, it's halved. You could play with that in terms of extending the duration of time if you want to achieve what you need for a target. And it works most of the time at reasonable temperature ranges. When you're working with solids and things start to heat up and you're charring your samples, I don't think it's linear anymore or logarithmic. There's something else going on. It's very helpful to think about this when you are under or over degrading your sample and you want to hit the target. Just a gratuitous chromatogram or set of profiles showing what happens with thermal stress. At the top is a blank. Second from that is a control. And then you have increasing amounts of heat. And really with a situation like this, by the way, you're getting somewhat of a non-specific degradation pattern, although you are seeing some things emerge as majority peaks, if you will. And in this particular sample, I'll bet good money that the appearance didn't turn black, but instead just maybe changed color a little bit, because you never want to work with charred samples. Those are usually pretty useless and hard to work up anyhow. But what do we want to look at when we're making all these degraded samples under various stress conditions? Okay, first things is that you want to look at the response factor of your parent component. So forget degradation products for a minute. You want to look at your parent peak, and you want to take that area count and divide it by the sample weight or concentration. So you can normalize everything. And then what I'm going to point to here in the control is you define that as 1.0, where everything else is compared to it. So in this particular set of data, one can see that the only appreciable change starts to happen 120 degrees for 2 days, where you lost about 0.45 or 45%. That's actually somewhat over-degraded, by the way. Okay, but it may still be a useful sample if your pattern isn't too complicated. You could do a similar thing for the aqueous samples as well. And what you get right away is an understanding that something is grossly bad or not so bad in terms of a condition for the material that you're working with. And I think we could agree too much heat is bad, just looking at that one number. And if I had to look at anything else, I would guess that acid is pretty harmful to this as well. We write degraded when material has completely gone away, of course. But in addition to that, you want to do acknowledge your degradation products. Now, I'm not intending that people read the slide, but I want people to appreciate the complexity, if you want to call it, or the amount of detail of how you look into things. And what you have here in terms of the columns is the impurity that you see, and then the rows would be your different stress treatments. It's almost like you take all your chromatograms and you condense them into a table. So when you write a report, you should show chromatograms because people like a visual. But this is an alternate visual, and it numerically tells you how much degradation did you get. The interesting thing happens when you're trying to achieve mass balance. I'll have a slide for that shortly, but you'd like to think that if you lost 45% in terms of your parent component, do you see 55% remaining? I got that a little mixed up. If you lost 45% of your parent, do you see 45% showing up as a sum total of all your impurities? So that's something we want to keep in mind. But this could help you address whether or not you're getting good mass balance or you're not doing so. I did want to mention how long do you go on stress treatments. And I've kind of alluded to this throughout the talk. But you want to focus mostly on solid material stress treatments. So this is also about design and how you want to have the best path to getting where you need to get as fast as possible. So remember that the solid material wins here, okay? You're really trying to support real-time stability where solid is exposed to heat, humidity, maybe light. Make the best effort possible to get degradation for thermal stress. If no degradation at 120 degrees by 7 days, you likely can stop. Now, some people might say, you gotta force it no matter what you do, but there's a point of reasonableness. And if you think about this Arrhenius concept that I mentioned before, 127 days, I'm going to just do this little mental drill. 110 degrees, 14 days. 100 degrees, 28 days, or about a month. You're kind of tracking this, okay? And then 2 months at 90, 4 months at 80, at 70, you're about 8 months. And you're getting close to a year. And I think you could imagine as you get to about 40 degrees, which is the top out temperature for typical stability studies, nothing's going to happen. Okay, so you want to be careful, you want to justify it, but you have to have a certain amount of reasonableness in how long you get to cook a sample. Consider aqueous unbuffered stress as an extreme humidity exposure. In case the 55 degree, 80% humidity design we use for 7 days is not enough, if there's any skeptics that we didn't go to enough of an extreme, submerging your samples in water is certainly a valid way to get at it from the other side, so to speak. Stress for light at 1 to 2x the ICH limits. That is somewhat required based on the ICH guidance. And aqueous conditions typically view these as informational. I don't want to dismiss their importance, but generally for our world of drug substances, we don't have to have perfection on or around the aqueous conditions. We do develop our methods to cover all these bases, okay? All these treatments. And I just wanted to make the point that if you don't see any degradation by 55 degrees after 2 days, you could probably stop. I don't think you need to have acidic samples going for 2 months stress treatment at some higher temperature just to make it break down. And I think the industry generally supports that. What really matters? Real-time stability studies. Real-time degradation products are the impurities of interest and concern. We need to acknowledge the ICH limits for reporting, ID, and qualification, of course. And this figure just shows the arms of a stability study. Mass balance. Revisiting this from a few slides ago, we need to have it. You need to understand what's going on. And it would be ideal if you could see it all in your forced degradation work, especially on the thermal and humidity exposure parts. To get mass balance, it works off the assumption that all degradation products have the same response factor as the parent component. And that's not always the case, but it's something that you'd like to have happen. And that's why we say it's ideal. It may be difficult or impossible when breakdown products are poorly chromophoric or they give poor response by the primary detection technique. And that's where you need to consider orthogonal methods for evaluation. Consider also the idea that if you heat a sample high enough and it contained a lot of solvents and a lot of water, you might drive those off. And that could skew the mathematics as well. But there should be awareness of mass balance. Never look like a deer in the headlights when this question comes up. Be ready to answer it. Also, beware of what is formed. Some compounds degrade to impurities of toxicological concern. So if in a real-time stability, you're forming a notorious PGI or potentially genotoxic impurity, that's a problem, okay? There should be sufficient knowledge of the chemistry ahead of time so that people can imagine the different degradation pathways. So the think tanks around every project should really have this in mind. An example, there is an anti-tuberculosis drug that actually forms hydrazine when degraded. So that is an issue for whoever owns that project.